So I want to go over the psychology behind the principle of polarity, behind that supply and demand, and why it is that one turns into the other. So here's an example of a stock trading at $30, okay? Now let's say somebody tells me, an analyst tells me that at $30 I should be buying it, okay? And I don't necessarily trust this analyst or friend or colleague, so I'm just gonna watch it. So I'm told at $30 a share that I should be buying it, and I don't. Then the stock starts to appreciate, $31, $32, $33, and the only thing that I can think of is, man, I wish I would have bought that stock at $30 like my colleague told me. If it only gets back to 30, I can get that opportunity again. But then what happens? The market continues to appreciate in the opposite direction, $34, $35 a share. At this point, I didn't buy it at 30 like they told me to, so I'm just frustrated and can only dream of the riches I would have made had I listened. So if only I get another opportunity to buy it at 30. So with the magic of the market, it starts to fall in price. Prices go from 35 down to 34, 33, 32. I could feel it coming. We're getting down to that $30 level so I can buy it. Sure enough, it gets to $30, we buy it. Now let's reverse that. And let's just say that I did buy it. And now the stock goes to $35 and I'm up 5 points from the $30 entry point. I'm super happy, right? I did the right thing. But then that greed factor kicks in. I didn't buy enough shares, right? So you're always wrong, whether you didn't buy or you didn't buy enough, right? If you're right on the stock, you didn't buy enough. And if you're wrong, you bought too much, right? That's how our minds think. So it's important to recognize that. So now I was right on the trade, but clearly, in my opinion, I don't own enough shares. So if only I can get back down to $30, I could double up on my position and own as many shares as I should have bought the first time around. So then, of course, the price of the stock starts to fall, 34, 33, 32, and then eventually when it gets down to 30, I go ahead and buy it. So now you have two sets, two groups of people that either bought it or didn't buy it, but there is memory at that $30. So when it returns down to that level, you're gonna get a combination of buyers, of people that did buy it the first time, but think they didn't buy enough, or that didn't buy it at all, and now they're getting their second chance. So if you miss it at 30, when it gets back down to 30, that support really comes into play. So now let's flip things the other way around. Let's say instead of buying the stock, my colleague suggested that I went ahead and shorted the stock instead. So okay, so I listened to my friend, and at $30 a share, I short the stock because I think it's going to 20, or so my colleague convinced me that it is. So I short the stock at 30, essentially betting that the price of the stock is going to fall, and then what happens? It goes to 35. The pain in my stomach of being wrong is something I just can't handle. I shorted too many shares, I was wrong. Man, if the stock can only get back to 30 where I originally shorted it, I could then break even, cover those shares, and just call it a wash. But now I'm getting killed. So as the price of the stock starts getting back to where I shorted it, I get back to break even and I buy the stock. So now you have three sets of buyers. The buyers that bought it the first time and didn't buy enough. The ones that didn't buy the first time and now they have a second chance. Those who shorted the stock and now can cover it, right? You have many groups of people. So when the longer that prices touch a certain point, the longer it stays at a certain level, the more important that level is.